pleasure to sincerely welcome you all to the third inaugural lecture of our great university, titled History, Culture and Resistance. Today, history is being made in our university, as this is the first inaugural lecture to be delivered by a professor from the Department of History and International Studies. And also the first to be delivered from the Faculty of Arts. I therefore congratulate Professor Amin Zaigi, the Department of History and International Studies, and the Faculty of Arts on this epoch-making event. It's a testimony of our collective efforts and commitment to put the university on the tripod of greatness. No doubt, our united and sincere efforts have started yielding fruit. We are well on the way to making our university one of the top 5 universities in Africa. I enjoin all staff and students to keep the spirit of teamwork to practice. Our university has greatly witnessed its momentum in academic activities. The members, the number of conferences, seminars being organized by various departments, faculties, and being hosted by the university is increasing dramatically.
Professor Amin Zaigi Ngharen has served the Federal University of Lafia in several committees, including the University Survey Committee, Departmental Postgraduate Coordinator, Faculty of Arts Representative on the Postgraduate Board, Hall Advisor, Editor, Lafia Journal of History and International Development.
Autonomy. Cultural resistance was resorted to by the imperialized on the realization of the disparity between them and the new invaders. It was adopted as a subtle form of resistance, as the communities of the Middle Belt sought to remove themselves from the colonial sphere of influence rather than to challenge it, because there came a point that challenging the colonial structure, colonial order was suicidal. So they resorted to other forms of resistance. This became necessary when open or military confrontations proved abortive or resulted more in the humiliation of elders and desecration of the land. Communities adopted multifaceted tactics and ways to reclaim their humanity and dignity. Community activists, sacred designers, religious leaders, artists, specialized guilds, and the rest of them used cultural resistance to relate with the population, influenced by whatever circumstances to build community participation. Cultural resistance was a discourse. It was a complex marketplace-like convergence of intellectual exchanges as a result of fertilizing experiences in practice, involving many members of the society, all of them endeavoring to manipulate ideas available to them in order to explain, blame, or otherwise make sense of their imagined reality. Cultural or institutional resistance, therefore, became a mosaic of components and the best option of confronting imperialism. It was largely non-violent, but the safest and guaranteed way to absorb austerity from the corrupting influences of the occupiers. It was more lethal way to resist foreign ideas and influences by attacking them from the mentality of the people. Colonization, in whichever form, has always been achieved or initiated by brute force. Its full potential has often been achieved by cultural imperialism. For example, the Spanish forced acculturation on Latin Americans. They began with the conquest of the Aztec Empire and the forceful suppression of Mesoamerican culture, which meant the Indians could not learn or transmit their culture, while compelling them to read and write only in Spanish. The Dutch did the same in East Indies, just as the British and the French did in India and Africa. Thus, the best way to counter cultural imperialism was through cultural resistance of the communities, as they did with other empire builders before the arrival of the British. Strangely, the British disregarded the religious and cultural nationalism of the people. and dismissed it as the work of some dissatisfied juju priests. Little did they realize that the priests and elders represented the real leadership the people recognized and obeyed. The cultural resistance in the Middle Belt area was slightly different from the Mao Mao movement and the Maji Maji movement that were, you know, that took place in East Africa, Kenya and Ethiopia, and Tanzania. Unlike the Mao Mao movement and the Maji Maji movement that resorted to physical violence, cultural resistance among the people of the central Middle Belt area was non-violent. They used culture to fight and they dealt with the minds of the people instead of using arms. The cultural resistance of the Middle Belt people involved forms of religious modifications and rebirth. The development strived in an environment, this development strived in an environment of apocalyptic innovations, mimicking and mocking several things, including church people and Islamic abolition. The people had a way of fighting to absorb their communities from this. And I'll be looking at some of these things later on. These practices became very powerful anti-colonial and all forms of foreign invasion movement. On the plateau, for example, there was one Bewaran, the Ngolo of Kabu. He was Elda's chief. He converted to Christianity when he was married to several women before the conversion. And some of the women, 18 of the women that he was married to, were married to the throne, not to him as a person. So when he converted to Christianity, he had to face the problem of missionaries. You are supposed to keep only one wife. And this man had 18 wives. He could not divorce a single one of them. Because it was unethical, it was not normal for a man who was still alive to divorce his wife, because nobody would get married to her. And so that was a serious, serious challenge that he had. So the missionaries had to allow him to convert to Christianity and to retain his 18 wives. Before doing that, the traditionalists forced him to abdicate the throne, because the other option was for him to die. And since he didn't want to die, he had to abdicate the throne. But remember that he could not divorce any of the wives. He had to keep all of them. In fact, writing about that, the officer in charge of the Hill District, one Captain Volkes, expressed his frustration and inability to help this man. And this was what he said. Among the pagans, secular and priestly function are so intricately mixed that the relinquishment of priestly power must necessarily result in the loss of temporal authority. For the power of the chief is largely based on his claims to be the tribal intercessor with the tribal deities. He continued, it is the custom for the king to shout and sing first and for others to follow afterwards. The Nga's kings are both high priests and kings at the same time. As king, he must take the lead in all the customs and social ceremonies. And to usurp this prerogative is an offense. With us, he said, our king could afford to ignore such insults. But with these pagans, who are hidden, hidebound by custom, such insults are not permitted. Negro custom, he continued, is more fixed than any other in the world. They have a longer, continuous existence, uninterrupted by outside context or ideas, than any other. They are the outcome, not imitations, of higher civilization, not the reaching after ideas, but of the practical, everyday experience of thousands of years. And as such, though armed with the gospel, we cannot ride, shoot over them. End of this statement. Another interesting aspect of resistance to foreign domination among the societies in this area was the role played by religious leaders. The presence of the jihadists previously and later that of the British Empire builders in the area was seen as one and the same thing. It was considered abominable, contaminable, and total violation, which required spiritual attention and cleansing. And the religious leaders, especially the seers and the prophets among them, inspired and mobilized and motivated their people to face the uncertainties of the time. The soldiers were often given some potions, supposedly to make them invisible to the British. Chants and sacrifices were supposed to keep them safe from the bullets of the British, just as they had successfully repulsed others in the past. Mr. Vice-Chancellor, the recent resurgence of such practices within the Middle Belt area, particularly among our societies, the Jukun, the Ibira, the Mukun, the Egon, the Mada, the Rindre, the Tarot, and several other indigenous societies across the Middle Belt area, it's a sign that such forms of resistance has become necessary again. It is such a huge cultural movement that is sweeping across the land, and the emerging army is now referred to as hunters. We hear about hunters, civilians get here in the northeast and all around. It's the same thing. They don't be Christian. And several communities here call them in various ways. The Jukun call them Ambafan Bakunjin. And the Igala call them Ajugun. The Ibira call them Uzi Idu. And just like the Egon call them Mbatse, the Mada call them Brennan. And we call them Vigilante. The chief also calls them Mbatiev and the rest of them, JTF and the rest of them. The same thing. Okay. So the emerging scenario has made African traditional religion even more attractive and more populated than all the others put together. And this is strange, but it's true. For indeed, most members of modern religions are mere part-time members. Even some leaders of the modern religion who criticize these people in the daytime, visit them in the night. Mr. Chairman, the culture of resistance is a product of the history of the Middle Belt area. It evolved historically and reflects the history and value system part of that history. Therefore, the resort to invoking all forms of resources on fighting or resisting domination seems natural, and therefore thinking or acting otherwise would appear treacherous. You appear as cowardice, or in fact, both. It is against this backdrop that we can situate the current type of contestation, which reflects an outlook. It expresses an outlook that Christ has so loved that the communities are feeling threatened again. The society is also embarked on magical resistance. When the warriors discovered a disparity in arms between them and the British, and in order to rid their communities of British invaders, famous medicine men involved their magical prowess. Ancestors, community leaders, spiritual intermediaries, and the rest of them were called upon to take action against the helmet, the pink helmet wearing invaders. Widely famed medicine men were also believed to have successfully and severally struck blind the invading troops or scattered them with swarms of bees. The British invaders were repeatedly forced to reconsider their strategies in dealing with some of the communities of the Middle Belt. As it turned out, the communities were often deserted or empty each time the colonial invading forces arrived. This could be explained in two ways. Either actually their portions work, or the people had a superior intelligence gathering technique and had a way of knowing that the British were coming, forces were coming before they arrived. Because each time the British arrived, the communities, the people will have disappeared long before that. There is nothing wrong if we also make history lessons compulsory for all our politicians. Because you can't govern the people if you don't even know their history, you don't even know who they are.
On behalf of the Inaugural Lecture Committee, I'd like to thank all of you for being present for this event. If this hall, if you were not here, and this hall was empty, the purpose of the lecture would have been defeated. Thank you very much for coming. As our chairman said, this is the last for this year. But at the beginning of the new year, we hope to invite you again. And when we do, we hope you will be in attendance.
such truth has been laid there. And some of the things I said are not easy to say. They are the truth. And once it's the truth, you speak it, you say it. So I'm satisfied that I've been able to say some things. This has been my research interest, and I have been able to explain some bit of what it is all about.
For a professor newly appointed or promoted to that position to come and tell the public the journey he has from the beginning of his academic career up to the level of professorship. And along the line, we know every academy, as you start your career, there must be a lot of challenges and other aspects of joy within your career, which you experience. So it is this kind of occasion that the professor will have opportunity to tell the public, so that the younger academy will learn from.